I say that like I'm ever ready for this. Oh gosh.
But I'm ready for that. I am.
Well, at least one of us is. So, tonight is one of those nights where we don't play a game. Tonight is the night that we do our story time chit chat, which is bi-weekly. And we're going to take a second here. We're already starting a little late, but that's just because I couldn't find my spoons. But I got a few now, so we're all good. I don't even know if I have a few, but we're going to fake it, guys. We got this.
We're going to fake it until
we're going to fake it. And we're going to make something of the debacle that is my streams. So, anyways. Okay, Coolio. All right, wonderful. I say that. So aggressively. Because so tonight we got some lo-fi playing in the background for some funsies. I'm hoping that I'm going to remember. Hey there, lovely.
How's it going, Z?
I almost called him husbando. I don't know why.
Oh my god.
He's my stream husband. Watch out. Just kidding.
Look out.
My viewer husband? I don't know. Just claiming Z, apparently. Anyways, STCC is live, mother peppers. So, we got, thank you. Aw, you guys are so sweet.
We try to be.
So tonight we're going to be discussing chapters 59 through 63 of When Souls Awaken. So, lots of shit to cover. I'm hoping that the music isn't too loud. And of course I say that as it's in a like little spot where it does nothing, apparently.
Yeah, Z, just do us a favor and let us know if the volume is balanced right for us when the music comes back in.
It's starting back up. I just popped away my avatar for a second there so I can recalibrate its, because apparently I was sitting in a really bad body posture when it started, so it's like, yo, you're staring at the ceiling, right? I'm like, brah, no.
Mm-hmm.
All right, here we go. Anyways, hello, wonderfuls. We are back for another story time to chat. I have my mic in a new position. Actually, I had it for last night's stream too, but it makes it a little harder to do hand motions because I'm gonna smack it because it's literally right here. So, like. So we're gonna have the left hand today. I hope you like lefty. Anyways,
never mind. Go ahead.
Anyways, so we got some chill lo-fi beats in the background because I don't know. I like it. I'm glad it's doing good. So this is the channel that on YouTube that I'm using for this music is called The Relax Movement, but you know, so, sorry, I just got distracted reading the thing. But anyways, I was just like, oh shit, it says make sure. And I was like, so I quickly read it to make sure I wasn't like violating anything that I was using.
Turns out you're like violating the Geneva Convention.
Yeah, right? Nah, it just says.
Immediately commit a war crime.
It just says, just make sure, you know. That people know about it so they can use it too. And I'm sure. Well, this is the relaxed movement. Real super chill. You want the link? There it is. Check it out, my guys. It's super chill. Anyways, I hope you like the little promo I threw together for like 5 seconds that you're only going to see here. Unless I like edit it for the YouTube video or something. Pop up on there. But I thought it was a nice little thing. So, If you're not familiar with the story time to chat, basically I just sit here and break down my chapters that have recently released there. I have covered every single chapter that has been released for free up to date. This is actually story time to chat the 20th and 21st because I skipped one when I was on vacation. But anyways, and this 20th was Oh my god, I just realized that. It's the 2021 Storytime Chit Chat in 2021.
Hey.
I don't know why I made that noise. Oh god, somebody get me a drink.
You're lovely.
Thank you, thank you. Anyways, so without further ado, let's make sure. Okay, I do not have that set up. I was like, let me make sure it's right for when I switch. So that way you see Cease's avatar rather than, you know,
just the random stuff, yeah.
Other than, you know, my Discord's, like, a really random spot of the Discord announcements.
That would be interesting.
That'd be something. Anyways. So, here we go.
That's funny.
Now I'm mad. What? Because I set up this whole nice thing, and now I realize that the chat is right behind it.
Well. Rip.
So much for that extra 5 fucking minutes I spent. Oh my god. And my avatar is behind it. So much for making it the stream slightly late. Don't worry, guys. I'm gonna fix that real quick, and then we're gonna pretend we have spoons and be like, don't worry, brah, don't worry. Oh fuck, I don't mean to open that. God damn it. Chill out. Oh no. Oh no. We're worrying. We're worrying, guys.
We're worrying.
I don't know. Someone please help me.
Do you want me to come over there? I can help you out. I'll be there in like an hour.
Alright, so the stream is postponed for an hour now because I'm just kidding.
No.
Wasa focus. Let's edit that real quick, guys. Let's edit that. We're gonna poke the eye on this real quick. Sorry, guys. Sorry. And we're just gonna shove this in this corner. We're moving corners for you, Z. We're shoving it in that corner. Yeah. And it just wiped the chat. Someone say something.
Wow.
Ooga. 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 Okay, that works. Amanda. What's up, buddy?
Hi,
Furball. So, you know, that's going to bother me now that you're not have my book screen. But I want to have my chapter thing here.
I like it like that.
You know what? I think I could put it here and still just unpoke it. So watch chat. Sorry.
I just realized your avatar is also in front of your Ko-Fi thing.
Yes, because I forgot to move that forward too. Guys, this is what happens when I make the stream late for making last minute new adjustments. All right, I appreciate you, Bloody.
Yeah, thank you for
good
lurking.
Luck with your streamy weemy. I don't know why I called it a streamy weemy, because we're all a little unhinged in this Chili's tonight.
Oh, hon.
So.
Mm-hmm.
We're just gonna. Apparently, so there we go. That's just gonna have to work, guys. Cause
I think that's fine.
Now my Discord overlay is weird, but that's fine because I can just shift the fuck out of that too. We're just keeps flapping up there. I don't know. We're just gonna bloop. There we go. That should work. That should do well. Okay, there we go. Anyways, welcome to Storytime Chit Chat. Sorry, I heard a door close and I thought they were like about to burst in here because that's usually what happens when things start going crazy. Remember, we have lurk commands. We do, Z. We do. I'm gonna be apparently covering chat a bit with the way my you know what?
A little bit.
Maybe if I just do this. I'm sorry, this is gonna just annoy the ever-loving shit out of me if I don't like have problems.
You're doing your best, hon.
Yeah, we do. We also have wonderful Nightbot.
We do have wonderful Nightbot.
Okay, there we go. That should work, kinda.
Yeah, that worked. Good enough.
We'll just shift it down a little bit more. And put an F in the chat for all the wasted time. Okay, because it works. Wow, my F looks so fancy.
I want to see if mine is like that now.
Yes, yes. It's because I set a something. A font.
I like the font.
That should... You like the font?
I like the font.
Alright, we're saving it one more time. Because I'm so sorry, guys. Where's
You're
this?
Doing fine, Amanda.
We're pretending okay. We have our life together, but we really don't.
No, it's okay.
Oh, crap. Can I move two things at once? Because I don't want to have to line it up again. Looks like I can. No, I can't. It's okay, guys.
Well.
It's okay. It's okay. It's just going to freak the fuck out for a moment. No.
Oh, my God.
Oh, wait. I know why. Probably because of that. Yeah, there we go. Ha! We can move two things at once. Watch out, guys. We're on top of our fucking tech world, right? Okay, yeah, never mind. Don't ever come to me for tech advice. Anyways.
I just love the dichotomy between we don't have our life together. Yeah, I'm on top of the tech world.
But then I wasn't. Oh, can I do that? Can I... No, I can't. Alright. Anyways, sorry guys,
anyways,
I was trying out a new thing. Anyways, so we're only 20 minutes into our story time chit-chat and we haven't done anything with story time chit-chat.
RIP.
I hope you guys still love me. Anyways, so let's just jump in, I guess. So, 59. As you can see, I threw the chapter icon up there. I spend all this time making them, and I don't know why, because no one sees them. Except unless I, you know, bother my Discord with them. Actually, I do use them for my promos, for my story throughout the week. But, you know, I only do one per chapter. Anyways, so 59, we start out with feeling fear. And, you know, I really actually quite enjoy this chapter icon in particular. I was so happy with the way it came out. So happy. So it's a broken bone, if you couldn't tell, with basically the idea is that Santa Kiro's sneaky snake stuff. Because it's not so heavily... Santa Kiro's... there's a snake in the Vismundas that is actually named after, you know, Santa Kiro because of the properties of its venom. But that's something that we'll see in When Gods Slip, which is the sequel, the eventual sequel to this, which is partially written. And apparently my leap motion is really freaking out about whatever. So it's only picking up hand motions a little bit. Okay, there we go. If I roll back a little bit, it's a little happier. I think it was thinking my mic was my hand. So, thank you. And it's no S, Mr. Edwick. Not trying to flip you off there. Wow. Thank you, Avatar. Anyways.
I appreciate you.
Thank you. So just start. So appearing characters in chapter 59, Feeling Fear, is Core Axis, Zonked Out Alora, and Kiro. So to outline, like that isn't the whole entire thing we do. Anyways, to start off with some imagery in the first paragraph, I just like to point out, like, that's described in there. I just like, why isn't it working? Nightbot, you suck.
That's a good question.
I don't know. I'm having issues all over the fucking place.
Yeah, we'll take care of it later, though.
It worked for me. Nightbot, you're just driving me crazy. That's okay. You can take my stealth roll there, Edwick. It'll be fine. It'll be fine.
I'm gonna try now.
Nightbot's just being a dick to Edwick, apparently. Thank you. Anyways, as I was saying, I just like to point out, you know, with the imagery.
It
and
didn't
this...
work that time, but that's because I used a capital I instead of an L.
Oh. Anyways, to start off, let's just restart. Let's just fucking restart. Just bash my head into the wall, guys. It's fun.
To start off with some of the imagery
in the first paragraph, I'd just like to point out that it's supposed to be representative of Allura in the Abyss. Like, in a way, you know, kind of hidden by darkness, but still there. Anyways, we start off with the arrival of Axis, Allura, Kor to Kuro's clinic. Right off the bat, we see that despite whatever feelings Kor holds for Axis, it pales in comparison to how he feels for Allura. And Kor suggests that, you know, he will grow unforgiving to Axis if Axis continues to hurt her, whether by accident or not. He's like, you need to get your shit together, boy. You need to. You can't just keep burning her alive, like, literally. She has enough scars. She has enough trauma. Please stop.
Please stop lighting her on fire. It's rude.
Right? So rude. Anyways, so, I know we just got started, but do you like my frame? I love my frame. I thought it was pretty.
I love your frame. It's adorable. It's beautiful.
In 1 minute.
Amanda, it is as gorgeous as my opinion of you.
I don't know how to get away from that compliment. Anyways, before long, we have Kuro stepping onto the scene with a clever line of, I thought I heard a dog barking, because, you know, Axis is yelling. but, you know, he's kind of thrown off by the fact that Kor is there with the broken Allura. I mean, what did he expect? But it's mostly because he's finally pieced together the stuff that we, that, you know, the reader gets to learn, you guys get to learn, at least blatantly, in chapter 61. So, Kuro's ahead of the game. He's the one that always, he'd like, kind of figure out what's happening before, you know, anyone else. However, one of the main points is, you know, is to start establishing how out of touch the god of Omnia is to human emotion in this chapter. That's what part of this whole chapter is. It's about telling you how, you know, Kor really is, you know, we see him being rather curt with Kuro, and even threatening him before the good doctor decides to tell Kor that he's experiencing fear. And Kor, honestly, you know, was not even, consciously aware of this until Kuro pointed it out. So after that, we see Kuro set to work on Allura with Axis holding her hand all the way through, at least as best he could without getting in the doctor's way. And Kuro just is like, yeah, you'll be fine. You just stay out of my way. You let me do what I need to do and you can stay. But don't cause me any issues. Otherwise, I'm throwing you out. Mm-hmm. Once Kuro finishes all he can for Allura, though, he goes and confronts Kor and gets really vague answers. If you ever played Dragon Age or Mass Effect, then I can tell you that each time Kuro asks a question, he can just feel the Kor disapproves +++. Or Kor disapproves greatly. And it's just like, yeah.
Everyone disliked that.
Yeah, basically. During this, we also see more similarities between Kor and Allura in the sense that Kor dodges answers like she does in a way. And he kind of just fucks off, you know, after Kuro comes to realize that even Allura doesn't know the truth about, you know, what he's suspecting. Yeah, so, like, I mean, Kor is, you know, deflection. But, yeah. When Kor leaves, though, from this scene, he goes to Allura in the Abyss, and we see that her hope is born anew with seeds that represent Axis and Flora, and the tree that's in its center, the baby tree, represents herself and Kor. Just as the chapter is wrapping up, though, we see Allura asking what it is she's missing. And it's important to note that Allura has opened her eyes, like Kor told her to before. She's awakened the power, but he is choosing to withhold more from the situation. And when he says, I will tell you when you are ready, does he really even mean that? Or does he mean that when he's ready? You know, this is likely the first time that Kor has ever considered someone as an equal in his lifetime, which is all of existence in this world. And a lot of this will be focused on in chapters 61 and 62. But in the next chapter, we will be focusing more on Flora, which is chapter 60, as days go by. So,
as the days go by,
right? Look, there goes the number change, and here goes the little chapter icon. Yeah, so sometimes my chapter icons are really nice and cool and like really other time and then other times they're just like a bad bowl of soup.
And I'm not think even... that your bowl of soup is really good. You make really tasty soup.
No, no, I know I make tasty soup, but I mean, hold on, I gotta find this bowl of soup now.
I'm teasing you, hon.
I gotta. I actually, the soup isn't too bad, but no, I had like a really crappy icon. I don't know. I think it's the ass. I think the ass is kind of bad. Can't tell what it is, but either way, some of them are, you know, more like this, and then others are. I guess they're not too bad, but they're not that great sometimes. But anyways, if you want to see the soup, this is the soup I was referring to. We're at soup. It came out better than I remembered.
I feel like most of yours came out better than you remembered, and you need to, like, have more faith in yourself. Z, tell her to be nicer to herself.
Nah.
Don't make me get the Discord to gang up on you again.
Okay. Anyways, so, as I was saying, we're on to chapter 60. Mm-hmm. So, and that's As Days Go By. In this chapter, we have characters appearing as Flora, Mr. Penders, Axis, Zonk Delora, Rune, Cure, and Kuro. I keep referring to her as Zonk Delora because she's still in a coma. So, this chapter starts off with a callback. I love you, Z. Starts with a callback to the previous chapter. At least the imagery, the way it opens. So it says, at the beginning of this one, it says, the persistent sun penetrated the heavy clouds. This is a way of foreshadowing that Allura will awaken. But the continue to linger is saying it's going to be a bit. So in other words, Allura is still in a coma. And Flora is off visiting Mr. Penders for a much needed break. And she lightens her heart by sharing some of her concerns with him, such as her worries about Kor. Mr. Penders helps Flora to theorize about who Kor might possibly be, and they settle on him being a long-lost family member of sorts, maybe, kind of, I mean, maybe, who knows, I know, but, and Flora finds herself some hope in finding out something because, you know, as expected, you know, Kor is withholding information from Flora as well. And I mean, I mean, the hope that she's feeling isn't that she found out something, is that that she finally has the right question to ask to help her find out more. That's what I was trying to say. But I wrote it kind of shittily in my notes there.
Yeah, you're fine.
I didn't put any commas. I don't punctuate.
You have a comma there.
I do. I have commas in places, but not where I was. Yeah, anyway. Upon Flora's return to the clinic, we see that Axis has completely forgotten self-care while watching over Allura, and Flora is getting real tired of his shit. Real tired. But even as he, you know, breaks her patience a bit there, like, this isn't when she snaps, but, you know, she still tries to suggest things that might help him feel better, like, you know, sleeping beside Allura, because at this point, Allura is pretty well healed by Kuro's efforts. Flora then focuses on making sure that Axis is fed, and she runs into Kor in the kitchen. And we see when Axis presses her... Oh my god, I don't know why I said Axis. When Flora presses her theory to Kor, Kor just denies being a relative. He's like, oh no, I've known her for all. I've always known her, but no, I'm not her relative. Are you crazy? And then he keeps giving her unsatisfying answers. That happens to be the final straw for the poor girl in that moment. And she breaks down crying. But it's Flora. I mean, she cries at everything, but that doesn't make it okay. And she breaks down because nobody will tell her anything. And she's like, why? And she's just so sad. So sad. But Flora then focuses. Oh, sorry. Kuro walks in on this at the end of it when she's crying and whatnot, and we see Kor show a little bit of humility when he asks Kuro for help, and he finally admits that he has no idea what he's doing, none whatsoever. And Kuro agrees to help, which allows Kor to finish off the chapter with a big old smooch to Axis. Confused? Then go read it for free on Tapas Fictionator Wattpad. Anyways, on to chapter 61.
Yay! Confusion.
So appearing characters for chapter 61 include Kor, Alora, and then we also have Axis, but in a memory, we have Oscar, Adelia, and a doctor, we'll call him
Steve.
Tim. Okay, his name is Teeve. No. Named Teeve. Yes. For Tim and Steve put together. Or I guess Steve, but the S is silent. Silent. Steve, but the S is silent.
Mm-hmm. I love that you're actually writing that in the note, by the way. I just want everyone to know that she actually wrote that down.
Yeah, it was funny because I actually was going to just write a random name when I was doing the notes, but I was like, nah, I'll just name it on stream. It'll be fun.
Perfect.
So, beautiful. Again, no God chat. We haven't had any God chat for a hot minute. They're all kind of like shitting their pants because Abravis is back, but no one knows where he is. They're like, oh my God, he's just going to pop out of the walls. It was like me when I was playing The Exorcist on that last level looking for the boss. I'm like, I don't know where he is.
I loved that stream. I had so much fun.
Oh, I'm so glad to be done with it, but I did have fun with it. But the chapter starts off in the Abyss. And in this chapter, we have a lot of questions asked and spoilers.
Yeah, very, very spoiler heavy this chapter for anyone that has not read her stories. Just want to point that out.
One of the things we finally get is a name for the power that Alora holds now. And it's called Vispotentia. Which Kor explains as a violent power that can destroy anything. And yes, this includes gods. Does it include Abravis? I honestly don't know. Maybe? Probably not. I'm going to say no. I'm going to say that. I want to say no, but I don't know. Who knows? The power was never meant to be shared, though. And I don't believe any beyond Abravis were ever meant to wield it. The power requires perfect control for it to not backfire, and Alora was a natural in wielding it, which was just enough to keep her from killing herself. But that's why she like broke every bone in her body just now. The majority of Alora's injuries from her battle with the gods were unintentionally self-inflicted. I really enjoyed writing, like, I really just in general, I enjoy writing extremely overpowered characters that have such drawbacks that put them on level with everyone else just to keep things balanced. Like, I really enjoy it because, you know, there's one thing if you're like, oh yeah, they're fire mage, but they can only cast a fireball up to X amount of size because of this. But it's just like, I don't know. I'm like, this bitch can kill gods, but will probably kill herself. So she can do it once. I love the whole joke of, you know, you can go skydiving without a parachute once.
Yeah, I love that. All mushrooms are edible once, stuff like that.
Yeah, like that's the way I like to balance my characters. I don't know why. But not that there's anything wrong with the other ways of balancing characters. I love it. I love all of them. They're great. And in one of my other stories, one of the balancing factors is their mana pool. Is like a huge thing, and it varies, you know, it varies like height and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You know, some people have like a teacup of it, other people have like an ocean worth, but that's like unheard of too. But that was the first story I wrote, and maybe someday I'll rewrite it to actually publish, but we'll see.
There's
a lot to be done with that story. A lot.
I loved
maybe,
that story though.
Maybe if Patreons were interested, I could make a tier that it would be a higher up tier, but I could give you access to early works like that. Possibly.
That would be really cool.
Possibly. However,
I would definitely spend extra money for that.
I don't know if they would be. They wouldn't be edited or rewrote, and they'd be raw.
Oh my.
Anyways. So, back to the chapter. We get some backstory of the world as Abravis reveals what his view of the world is. You know, like, not like his life views or anything, but I mean, like, how he actually, like, you know, can go and see the world type thing. Mm-hmm. Like, how he, his own little asylum, so to speak. Because all the gods have asylums, as we know. Kuro is Sanctum, and Rixicalis is some mountain somewhere. Menchio has his own mountain as well. But, a lot of them like to dwell in mountains for some reason, but
I want a wizard's tower,
right? So back to this chapter. Abravis is showing her this without actually leaving Alora's abyss, mind you. He's just altering the way it looks, really. So it's more like he's showing a vision to her. He shows her the only evidence that's left of the previous worlds, which shows it, you know, in like a really decayed state. There's skeletons of unrecognizable animals, beings, and whatnot, you know. So it kind of suggests that, you know, humans weren't always the dominant species in each retake of the world. I mean, there's even a possibility that one of them didn't have humans and they had like a different race as the main race or only race that existed. But I'm not going to get too far into that because that's really just speculation and me just having fun. But this whole thing was just me having fun. So what they're doing is they're making their way towards the heart of the realm, so to speak. And this is, you know, and as they were moving through, we learned that the first god, Abravis, created... that the first god that Abravis created was Anima, followed by Mencio, and then Morsimum, rounding out the ancient gods. Because what happened was, you know, so at first Abravis brought in life, and then knowledge came when they experienced life, because they learned that there can be cruelty and other things, and then they wanted to end the cruelty. But they didn't want to end life permanently. So that's how death came to be. So life brought cruelty, brought the knowledge of cruelty, and death brought peace to that in a way. So it gets to be a circle because they didn't want to get rid of life because they really enjoyed it. They thought it was nice having all these people and animals about. But so that's the ancient lore of when souls awaken there for Vismundus. Fun bits, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So the visual of this, you know, of Abravis's view of the world is described as a field of flowers with intermittent trees all radiating from one big, like, ebony tree and it's, like, of impossible sizing. So if you watch our Valheim streams, it's kind of like the world tree, you know, like that sense of ridiculous size, you know? The flowers represent, in here, not in Valheim, each flower in... this asylum represents each and every life of Vismundus, and I mean like every life, with the trees representing the gods, and the center tree is representing Abravis. This idea was inspired by the Arbor Vitae, if I'm saying that right, but or the Tree of Life, or however you like to refer to it as. And those of you going, the Arbor Vitae is the, you know, isn't a tree, it's actually the cerebral white matter of the brain. Yes it is, and it's a nickname for that spot or whatever you want to call it. But that's also, you know, part of what helped me in considering, you know, the whole inspiration for it. That's part of where it came from. But it's called Arbor Vitae for its branched and tree-like appearance on the brain when you cut it, you know, it's a little tree. Mm-hmm. So you can almost think of, you know, Vismundus as the mind of Abravis in some, you know, convoluted way. But it's, so there's a lot of inspiration that comes from both sides, like, you know, all of it, which is, it's all fun. It's all fun. Anyways, moving on from our little anatomy lesson there and all, when Alora and Abravis reach the tree, they have a seat. They sit down. Then they're done. And the story's over. I'm just kidding.
Ta-da!
Ta-da! She's stuck in a coma forever. Damn, that sounds nice.
Manda, no.
but you know, and Abravis here starts to give Alora an answer she's been looking for. I'm not going to go into great detail here, but basically Abravis shows Alora memories of her parents. Like how they wanted her, how they lost her, how they begged to any god that would listen, you know, for Alora to live. And this utterly destroys Alora. All the, you know, guilt of killing them slams into her in this moment. And by the end of the memories, Abravis shows his involvement, you know, in this set of memories of, you know, sharing her parents, like devastation at losing her type thing. This is where he reveals his involvement in Alora's existence. Alora's heart didn't develop properly in the womb, or there was some sort of defect in a way that it was just not going to work. And the way Abravis,
yeah,
and the way Abravis has been, this is a huge like plot point of the story.
Yeah, this is a huge spoiler. But again,
in the way that, so Alora's heart didn't properly develop in the womb, and the way Abravis has been concealing himself for the past 1,000 years, it, you know, over 1,000 years, but we'll actually get to that exactly how long in a question later on, is by using vessels to hide his heart within. And the unborn Alora was a perfect candidate. We also witness his previous vessel dying when he, you know, takes back his heart. But poor Alex, you know, the vessel, looked a breath from death before he even took the heart. And it's suggested there that, that he knew Arun as Coco. Anyways, Alora is in a full-on meltdown, forgetting all the shit her parents put her through, and so Abravis is like, "Welp, I can fix this." And he quickly bombards her with all the trauma, because apparently he doesn't know any better. I mean, this is not a good way to deal with it, but I guess it's effective. I mean, oh my god, like, he just, Abravis just goes, "Oh my god, please stop crying, here's all your trauma. Relive it."
Like, look, it's not all bad that, you know, your parents are dead. I mean, they hated you.
Yeah. And it's just so funny when you think about how, like, how much Abravis loves and cares about Alora. And then he just, like, mentally, like, tortures her like this.
I'm just imagining now a meme for possibly like a meme Monday of him just like, there's two buttons and one is labeled, you know, give her therapy, and the other one is, you know, bombard her with trauma.
Yeah. So, however, I guess it's no surprise that after that, you know, emotional fuckening, that Alora is not too happy about learning, like only now learning about this. And she is just thrown into an identity crisis, questioning why he chose, you know, to show her that in that way in particular. She's like, why? Why? I would have listened to you.
Yeah.
Like, and now she's like, is that my only reason to exist? You know? And so, but Kor reveals that he really didn't think that Alora would, you know, that she would take him at his word. And that the only way she would believe him is if he showed her. But the truth is, she really would have believed him. He is one of the few people she would have taken at his word. And Alora just continues to shatter. Can speak.
This suddenly became a completely different kind of story.
It finally became the sweat that Ruby wants.
Yeah.
Anyways. But the sound... during all this horribleness, we... Alora, you know, it cuts over. Oh no, Alora pauses a bit, and like she's hearing something, and it cuts over to Axis, and because Axis's voice has started to reach her, she can't understand it, but it still brings about a calm for her that she needed. And the chapter ends in Axis's perspective with a heartbreaking question, and it was, you know, how can I make you smile if you won't wake up? All right, on to chapter 62. Hopefully it has a happier ending. Spoiler alert, it does.
Yay.
Because we all need something good after all that bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Seriously, it is heartbreaking to watch Alora's parent, like, to read Alora's parents, like, being like, "Oh my god, our child, it's dead. We're never gonna have our baby, please." Like, they're begging. It's so horrible. Mm-hmm. So horrible. And, and it wasn't their first attempt either. You know, her mother had several miscarriages before Alora. So it's like even more heartbreaking. It's very briefly mentioned. It's just like, you know, it's not directly mentioned either. So it's like, you know, if you picked up, good on ya. So chapter 62 is... Ah, fuck, I forgot to change my images around.
Ah, anyways, crap, yeah. Well, show us the thumbnails.
I'm trying.
Go 61 first. It's okay.
So
a lot of effort.
Look, chapter 61. we're going. Oh gosh, no. Oh no, I'm putting all the wrong buttons. This is just... Ah, there we go. Chapter 61. The reason why the icon is that way is it's Abravis's heart.
Yay.
And an outline of Allura that didn't come out too great, but you know, it works. I think it
came out nice.
But moving on to chapter 62. I love this chapter icon so much. So much. Mm-hmm. It is, it's supposed to be basically the essence of Allura holding Abravis's heart. Because she has now learned, and she is on her throne of darkness. And in chapter 62, it's very obvious why. So appearing characters, we have Axis, the zonked out Allura still, Flora, Kuro, and Kor. No god chat, because the gods are, you know, still being scared shitless. This is one of my, honestly, proudest chapters. One of my favorite chapters. And I know I say that, like, I know I get really excited a lot, and then I know I keep saying that, but no, this one is great. The mind fuckery that happens within it.
Oh god, yeah.
So Allura is still unconscious, and we see Axis contemplating their future together, promising Allura that he has plans for them. And Flora walks in on this very tender moment, which leads to him being immediately hostile, because of course he is. It's Axis. Once again, though, he is testing Flora's patience. But this time, when she snaps at him for it, he does, you know, he apologizes. Because he does realize that she's done a lot for him, despite being, you know, so blind to everything else that he's been blind to, you know, besides Allura. Because all he cares about is Allura. You know, he's like, that's my future wife. But, he's so in love with her. Allura, anyway, accepts the apology and promises to bring him food later before asking where Rune is. And Axis answers, you know, and she heads off to go find Kuro because he said he was, you know, Rune was with Kuro. The chapter then conveniently cuts over to Kuro, who is having a bit of a spat with Kor. And, you know, he is growing to be a bit desperate at this point. Kor is. Everyone is, honestly. And you have to wonder if Flora overheard their little spat before Kor fucked off into the abyss again. You know, because the clinic isn't huge.
No, it's not.
And she's not deaf, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, things to consider. Mm-hmm. Anyways, we follow Kor back into the abyss, where the vines and flowers of, you know, from the seeds that represented her hope with, Allura's hope with Axis and Flora, you know, have flourished everywhere. They're you know, the vines are wrapping it like protective armor, and the flowers are just making it beautiful. But the tree, her and Kor's tree, is infected by despair, and Kor panics. I'm particularly proud of the scene for the way that I wrote Allura toying with Kor. Nearly every word from her mouth during this like part is a threat, a warning, a promise, or a sign of her encroaching insanity.
Mm-hmm.
Remember how I said this has a happy ending? It really does, I promise. Allura has discovered that the abyss she is in, like that haven that Kor created for her, it is, you know, within her, and she has learned that she can control it just as well, perhaps even better than Kor. And Allura is very unhinged at this point, because she has been stuck in this coma for a while and has been mentally awake for it all. She's basically been in solitary confinement for her entire coma, because it's not like she's just been dreaming like a normal person. And it has to do with that use of Abravis's powers. It's not a normal coma, but so it's kind of amazing that she stays as solid as she does. But that's also why he created this haven for her, was because it was something better than being just trapped in darkness that entire time, basically. So Allura is very unhinged, but she is stable in her current insanity, so to speak. Her relationship with Kor at this point is severely injured after chapter 61 by how Kor showed her all the memories and then ripped her back to herself, so to speak, with her trauma. Mm-hmm. So during this, we have Allura consider throwing herself in the darkness, threatening to damn Kor to it as well, and also admitting that she would damn every soul that she's ever saved or, you know, helped just to protect Axis and Flora. Allura also reveals that she's finally figured out what it is she feels so that is so heavily missed by her. And it is, huge spoiler, unless you've read up to this point, it is her soul. She is missing her soul. Once again, yep. Allura starts to fall into despair here. But a familiar voice speaks. It, you know, ends up, like, if this didn't happen, she might have lost it completely, guys. Like, this was, she needed this. But a familiar voice, like, speaks, shaking the darkness almost, with complete, like, disdain for her, too. And it's Usko. Usko has arrived in the abyss, and he drags Allura's consciousness back to the waking world, so to speak, or whatever. And it's here that we switch to Axis's perspective, and it turns into this very nice little reunion with Flora walking in on it and Kuro as well. There's a few jokes and a little bit of fluff to celebrate Allura coming out of the coma. But it's just, there's so much darkness in this chapter, but it ends on a really happy note with everyone being able to go in a reunion like that. Even Kor's even Kuro is like smiling, and we all know the grumpy doctor.
Kuro doesn't smile.
Anyways, there's more fun to come in chapter 63. And I mean that. There's actually a little bit of humor.
Hey.
It's not all tragedy, guys, I swear. I think.
Mm-hmm. I'm proud of you.
Anyways, so on to chapter 63. Haha.
Oh, you did it this time.
Haha. There's a shirt. What happened to my hand? Anyway, there's a shirt. So appearing characters, again, we have Allura, Axis, Flora, and this time, Lyra?
Oh.
Remember her?
Yes.
From Flora's past? Let's hope this doesn't go horribly wrong. Anyways, so nothing in God chat. So the chapter starts off with Axis being a puppy and following Allura... I don't remember, but dun dun dun.
I'm proud of you.
I love you, bloody.
Good job.
You're wonderful.
Good job, purple.
Oh my god. So Axis is being a puppy and following Allura, much like my pug follows me. Seriously, the little guy runs into the back of my legs in the morning for like the first hour after I wake up every day, just because he missed me so much. It's pretty
adorable.
Aw, thanks, bloody. Hey. But anyways, everyone is super happy that Allura is back to being conscious. It's nice.
Mm-hmm.
But Flora is struggling for some reason, which may or may not be revealed in the chapter that drops tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, I'm so glad I wrote that because this feels so far behind me because I'm a week ahead with the Patreon's content.
That's definitely what is going on, honestly. Yeah, because I'm just like that just jutted me into perspective considering like what we just edited the other day.
Yeah, so tomorrow chapter 64 drops for free, and that's what I'm referring to for the chapter. If you are a Patreon subscriber, you already have chapter 64, and what drops for you tomorrow is chapter 65 and 66. Mm-hmm. Yeah, double feature. But not far in, we hop into one of Flora's memories that is of her time back at the orphanage with Lyra. And we see the two having a grand old time, you know, before sharing their first kiss. But it is instantly ruined when a boy comes along and calls her Flora a freak. Hopefully this isn't foreshadowing anything horrible with Lyra and Flora, but when we finish with this memory, we hop over to Allura's point of view rather than Flora's to see that she is looking for the pink-haired woman. Kuro points Allura in the right direction, and Axis is right on her heels, so much so that there's a fun little moment, and after a bit they're in the hall where Alora tries her absolute best to tell her fire puppy that she needs to go play with her other puppy. And Axis understands, but, you know, he's not happy about it. But he's not going to stop her because they have a healthy relationship. Please note that there isn't a single moment here that he even considers that Alora might leave the clinic to hang out with Flora to go do something. There's not even a, like, a inkling in his head that they might leave the building. He's just like, oh, they'll just chill in their room and talk. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
I can still see them when they go for the snacks or whatever.
Oh, you sweet summer child.
Right? Oh, poor Axis. Mm-hmm. He just got her back after being in a coma, and he's just, like, so attached. Anyways, after a few more moments to grow some more frustration, more cock blocking coming up. Well, actually, yes, but, no, but actually, yes. Alora manages to pull herself away from Axis with his help, believe it or read it. And she reaches Flora, who is crying alone in her room, basically. But, Alora soon...
That's okay, we all cry a little bit every now and then.
I'm crying on the inside right now. Alora soon reveals to Flora that the two of them are going to hang out as just the two of them. And Flora is overwhelmed with happiness for this, but... and this leads to the idea of going to the bakery for some treats. And this is where Alora learns that Axis has accidentally destroyed a lot of, you know, things. Actually, anything flammable that was in her room, pretty much. Which happened to be all of her clothes. Al is basically, you know, in a gown at the moment. But, yeah. So Flora then, quite innocently, mind you, offers her clothes to Alora to borrow. And this is inspired by one of my adorable short little petite friends offering me some pants to borrow. And it kind of, it worked, kind of, like, but anyways, didn't really work great when I bent over. But, you know, anyways, Alora is looking to, looking a bit squished with her curves in Flora's clothes. Alora would have borrowed clothes from Axis, but the guy only has one outfit. You know that outfit that he got in chapter, what was it? Like,
four or something.
Gifts, I think it was named. But that's still the only outfit.
Almost
he owns.
60 chapters ago.
Yeah, almost 60 chapters ago. Chapter 5. Thank you, Z. But, you know, that's still his only outfit that he has. Good thing they were enchanted, right? To grow with him and everything. Anyways, Axis is upsetty spaghetti that Al is leaving the clinic, but he's like, fine, borrow my coat. Well, actually, he makes a comment about not minding being naked for Alora first, but yeah, that's just Axis. And we get to see that Alora eye fucks Axis just as much as he does her. And then the chapter wraps up with Flora pulling Alora out the door, where she calls Alora out on being just as bad as Axis, but without the confidence.
Yeah.
She's just like, oh my god, you're just as much of a, you know, a freaking horny dog as he is. Except you just don't have the confidence and you don't know how to go about it because you're a big old virgin. But anyways, so that sums up chapters 59 through 63. Tomorrow, you know, 64 drops. So that's super exciting. But now I have some questions that were submitted. These questions, they were actually, I think they might have been submitted before I went on vacation. But I don't think these ones have been answered on stream. I tried to make sure that, you know, they're new ones, but we'll have to see. We'll have to see.
We shall see. We shall see. All right. Are you ready?
Cherry girl has no experience and no confidence or skill. Yeah, Alora is, Alora will, you know, kill you five different ways without even flinching, but, you know. She doesn't know how to bang you. Anyways, I am ready.
All right,
for
so.
These questions.
So, is it because Alora has Abravis's heart that. Okay, wow, this grammar. Okay, word for word. Is it because Alora has Abravis's heart? Part the reason why none of the other seers noticed that she was a mage? Question mark.
It's just like one Abravis. That's isn't that? That's how you spell Abravis.
Okay.
Leave it alone. Is it? Okay, is it because Allura has Abravis's heart the reason why none of the other seers noticed that she was a mage? I don't know why you had any trouble with that.
I had a lot of trouble with that.
So what they saw confused them, the other mages, with the ability to see souls. And they, but that's because they saw nothing. Like, seeing nothing is the reason for this. Which was actually vaguely, you know, revealed in a chapter. I say vaguely because Kor, you know, Allura cuts Kor off. You know, Kor says, each life, no matter how brief, is granted a soul. And Allura responds with, Araspoces would have it, would she not? And he goes, you'll never. And she goes, I know. So what's happening in this scene is Kor is saying that each life is granted a soul. And Allura is implying that, you know, when she died before birth, that her soul would have just went to Araspoces, the goddess of heaven. And what Kor is about to say is that Allura will never be able to retrieve her soul from there. So in short, all the gods that tried to make her a mage were trying to change a soul that was not there. Now, how is she able to use magic, you might wonder? This is revealed in Heartbeats chapter 61. Where, you know, because Allura is the vessel for Abravis's heart, which contains some of that of the primordial god's power. So, real quick, just for vocabulary, basically, and when souls awaken, the, you know, there's gods, and then there's ancient gods, and then there's the primordial god. Abravis is the primordial. Mencio, Morsimum, and Anima are the ancients, and then the rest are just gods.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, next question.
So what is she now? Is there a flower attached to the largest tree that is Abravis?
No. But Allura is human in Vismundus. So Allura is a human in Vismundus, separated from her soul that resides within heaven. As far as Abravis's garden is concerned, though, she does not exist or appear within it. So she's... I don't know, she's just something.
All right. You good?
Yeah.
Okay. So, in a way, Al is kind of undead, I guess. Question mark.
Next question.
Can Allura come back from this?
She will try to. Next question.
To think that her parents went so far and yet they treated her like crap. For what? Why would they do that?
Love the tone you ask these in. they did so because Allura. No, they did so because they did so because Allura killed the priest that tried to kill her. Her parents don't actually believe that she did it in self-defense, and even if they did, they still don't believe that there is ever or ever could be a reason good enough to actually kill someone. They worship life to a fault.
I like that, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good form of villainy. All right, so what happened to Alex, and why was he on death's door?
So this has been alluded to a few times, and will be addressed further later on. And like I was saying, you know, with I'm talking about more of why he was on death's door, not the whole, you know, ripping the heart out and thing, because we know he's a vessel. I just talked about all that, but there will actually be more about that, and it does have to do with stuff and things. Anyways, next question.
All right, so why would Kor pass Alex's heart along?
Because it was Kor's heart, you know, aka Abravis's heart. And this is, you know, as I said before, that he conceals his existence by using a vessel. Kor has basically, by using a vessel, he can basically go into incognito mode. He's looking up all the porn sites. Just kidding.
Perfect.
Next question.
All right. What was Coco?
Coco was Abravis in... He's a damn lich. Coco... No. Sorry, I got distracted by Z's message.
I love that, yeah.
But Coco was Abravis in sloth form, just like Rune is to Allura. Next question.
Does Abravis always hide out as a sloth? And why a sloth?
Yes. And as a play on the sin of sloth, because Abravis has basically taken a 1,000-year vacation. Next question.
So then Rune can hear the god chat.
Yes! Next question.
So how long has a vessel held his heart?
So, vessels have held his heart for a collective 1,068 years. The longest any one vessel has held it is 20 years. Not all the vessels have gotten it at birth. Some were actually already living their lives and whatnot. The oldest person to be made a vessel was 40 years old, and her name was Agatha. At no point does she come up in the story that I can recall.
Okay. So, when was the shortest?
The shortest vessel lasted 1 year. I don't know why. My notes are a bit sporadic on this. But excellent. I actually did, like, figure out how many exactly that there were and all. I don't know why. Because I thought I was going to need it for one bit of dialogue, and then Allura was like, nah. And Z said...
I do vaguely remember something about Agatha, though.
Yeah, I told you about her. I don't know, she might be referenced, but I don't really remember her coming up at, like, it's, I don't believe it being a plot point. Not enough of a plot point that I can remember, apparently. And Z said, here, little girl, take my heart / the phylactery and see you when you die so I can change batteries. Mm-hmm. Why is that so accurate?
It's pretty much.
Alright. Anyways, So I managed to make it through all my chapters. So now it's time to go to CC time. I hope you guys have enjoyed my time. Cause it's your time. Yes. It's your time now.
To shine.
See? Yeah. See that smooth change? For once in my life I did something right.
I like that. Look at this. Yeah, I can see I'm in my realm.
You're in your realm.
Alright. So hello everybody. Today we're going to be talking about chat system here. Alright, so today we're going to be talking about a very special character who's come a long way since her first inception. And the reason we're talking about her tonight is because she's actually been making a few appearances outside of the stories of the Aquinian Tales. So for those who are just turning in or who are not familiar with my work, I write the Aquinian Tales on Tapas. And so while I edit Amanda's work with her, she also then edits my work with me. So it's kind of like a partnership sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And unlike Amanda's singular long form story, I have a bunch of smaller stories and now
yeah,
one
fuck
story,
my story
that is
just kidding. I'm just kidding.
I adore you.
I adore you too.
But I have a bunch of... thank you. I have a bunch of smaller stories, and now I have one of those stories now is actually going to be a longer form story, and that is the Fel Ren, which is currently in progress, and you should check it on Tapas. It's part of the Aquinian Tales. But there are other stories on there that are already finished. You can binge the whole thing in one sitting if you want. Really easy to do. One of the characters from those stories, though, has been making appearances outside and interacting with people from this world. Her name is Cecilia Guelure. So it's come to my attention that Cecilia Guelure has managed to somehow get a Tumblr blog going. On there, she's been interacting with other Tumblrs, answering questions about magic in her home, and even offering the occasional impromptu lesson on magic using actual occult principles. She's actually talking about witchcraft and magic from an occult perspective, as it would work here on Earth, like if you were an actual like witch. So, really cool. She's also very curious about our world and its people, and has a strong desire to listen to the tales of others. This is usually fairly well innocent, but the other day she made a post asking if anybody agreed with somebody because they said that she had MILF energy and she thought it was something like magic related. It was a thing. So, you know, she's just, would you think that I have MILF energy? How can I use it in my craft? You know, that sort of thing. So now some of you may be wondering, now wait a minute, is this just an author insert? What the hell, Cece? So the answer is no. Not really, anyway. So Cecilia Guella Array got her name and personality long before my little discovery. It just so happens to be a good fit for me as well. So enough about that. Let's dig into a bit of her history as a character and how she developed. And I'm sure Amanda's going to want to chime in here and there, which you are more than welcome to do, Amanda.
She's come so far.
She has. So,
I have to say, my first opinion, honestly, of the first iteration of Cecilia was thought be gone.
Amazing. Yeah.
She was just thirsty and in a cave with no real weight to her character yet.
Yeah, well, it was just starting out. So far, it was her very first iteration. I love her now. And that's, me too. So a long time ago, Cecilia was imagined as a sort of rival to Elra, back when Arya and Elra were one person for a while. She had a bit of a different appearance back then, much dirtier robes, a heavy focus on necromancy as her forte in magic, because, you know, she was a dark mage that was living in a cave, using necromancy to survive the knights who are, you know, basically punishing anyone that uses magic. So she's just like, well, if they're going to punish anyone, I may as well deal with, like, the most dark and evil magic that I can, just because, you know, out of spite. Through her development in collabs, Cecilia went from being a very thirsty character with a clear interest in Feyre and Tella Culpa, to a more motherly character that, you know, still has a little bit of thirst, but has much more of an interest in just meddling in the affairs of others and just making sure that people are taken care of. She's actually supposed to have a much bigger role in future stories, but you can see her for yourself in the story Brooders, where she actually helps helps the main character kind of come into herself and discover things about herself in a very healthy way. Also a very, you know, motherly dom kind of way, but, you know, that's fine. So, anyways, nowadays that motherly personality is kind of her major trait, but she's still got that very dark witchy aesthetic. She is still capable of necromancy and will use necromancy when needed, both in terms of raising the dead, binding souls, and communicating with spirits. But her magic has more of a focus on other dark-related powers. She doesn't use the necromancy as much because it's... Well, we'll get to that a little bit later. But specifically right now, she specializes mostly in illusionary magic and summoning. So she'd be able to summon, like, a weapon, for example, or armor to help keep her protected, or, like, a spirit of some sort to help her in battle. She can also summon illusions to kind of, you know, make people think that there's more enemies than there are, or, you know, do other sort of psychosomatic stuff. On her Tumblr blog, though, she actually posts about real-world witchcraft. So she posts about sigil work, divination, warding, hexes, curses, things like that. Things that I talk about a lot on my Discord.
Bloody likes it.
Oh, thank you, Bloody. I appreciate that. So, if you actually ask Cecilia Guella Array a question about real-world witchcraft, she's going to give her best answer as per her understanding of the occult, which is, you know, going to have a lot to do with my understanding. And any Tumblr posts about Sigil Sundays and things like that are also going to be placed on her account from now on. Bloody says, I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate you too. Now, appearance-wise, Cecilia is depicted as having black hair with a green streak in her bangs. Her eyes are like emeralds, and she prefers flowing dresses that... Hey, look, wait, it's my VTuber avatar. How about that? Yeah, so... No, really, the VTuber that you're seeing, the avatar that you're seeing, is actually based directly on what are you doing to your breasts.
I was trying to do the whoosh motion for the dress. It's not my fault that my hand tracking stops right below my breast.
I'm so proud of you.
Can't
so there are
track past objects.
I appreciate you so much. So lewd.
Lewd.
But there are a few differences between Cece actual and Cece in, like, the VTube avatar. But we actually have a Picru that I made for her, using a Picru generator and everything that Amanda is going to kindly put up for me. That is a much more accurate depiction. So, Amanda, when you're ready.
Ta-da! It's already up.
Fantastic. the chat's kind of annoying. There we go. That's her. That's what she looks like. That is the closest, picture that I have for her, honestly.
Right? I love it too. It makes me gay.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I was gay before that, apparently, but yeah.
It does, and I am just, I very much appreciate that. That is very, that picture is gender envy. So there's, yeah, so, but basically that is pretty much what she looks like, including, like, the location, like, the position of the, green streak and the hairband and everything else. That's just perfect.
Yeah, oh, so Picker, you can actually, it's a site that you can use to make your own stuff. Like, you don't draw it, you just pick out the hairs and the colors, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it, and so you guys could all make your characters like this. It was really, I think it's Ren? One of the people that are on our server, they actually use Pick Crew to flesh out all their character designs. So that way don't have to draw them. I'm like, why don't I do that? That would be so fast.
It would.
Compared to like what I normally do. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's a really cool, basically like a little app or whatever that you can use. Super awesome. And that's Pick Crew. I don't have a link, but it's
pickcrew.me.
That basically, right?
No,
Pick
it's
crew like that? Is it spelled like that? No. Okay, that's... yeah. No, I wasn't putting the link, but
oh, well, I did.
Either way, that's there you go. So yeah. You can go have fun with that when whenever you want.
Yes, exactly. So now I can go on about Cecilia's history, but for now I'm just going to kind of give a couple of light teasers, because honestly what I'd really love is for people to actually interact with her on her Tumblr and let her kind of speak for herself. And I will be putting the link for the Tumblr. In fact, let me just do that right now. If anyone wants to just check her out and just chat with her. So that is her link for her blog. You can find her there.
Oh, now, sorry. I just wanted to add this since we were talking about chatting with characters. You can also bother her in the Discord if you're a part of the Discord, because that role-playing channel I have is all of our basically we pretty much only respond as our characters from our stories, and it makes for some, and you could be a character yourself if you want.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, go on.
So
sorry, didn't mean to interrupt too long.
No, you're fine. So yeah, just a couple of light teasers though about her history, just so you have some things that you might be able to ask her about. So Cecilia's hometown is the village of Gwellum. Gwellum is located in the southern swamps of the kingdom of Wulfrod. Now, generally it tends to act as kind of like a resting point for travelers that are trying to get through the swamps, because it's very harsh territory, and you know, being a swamp in a fantasy setting, you can imagine it's got some pretty dark creatures and monsters and stuff. This village is also home to... Yes, it's ooky spooky scary. The village is home to many mysteries, which I'm sure we're going to get to see as time goes on, but it's described as very like gothic in tone. Brick streets and buildings, you know, very not tall but steep buildings that appear much taller than they are because of that. You know, and you have these oil lanterns that kind of line the streets and everything, but you know, when the conditions are right, which is very often because of the swamp surrounding swamplands, there's a dense fog that can claim the village quite a bit. Really gives it a very eerie vibe. Her first appearance, however, actually takes place in a village in Fieldvin, which is where Brooders takes place, suggesting that our lovely Cecilia is actually a traveler of sorts. She does not tend to stay at home for very long. She tends to travel around. Like the city full of gothic architecture. Probably? I'm gonna guess yes. Sure. I don't know for sure.
You sound like me.
Well, you know, great minds alike think. So one thing of note was Cecilia. Her necromantic abilities specifically, and like a lot of her dark powers, are very similar to those used by members of the Cult of Penora. Which is, you're going to actually see those powers used by cultists.
They have great bread.
I'm sorry, what?
They had great bread.
What?
Okay. I appreciate you.
Panera. Panora.
Oh my god.
They have
I can't with you.
I made that joke too when it was Panobo. Panoba. Yeah, the cults had a few names. And I'm ruining them all, apparently.
That's okay. I just have to say the word Bakugo and that just...
Stop. Don't. I will take away your spotlight, Missy.
Please don't. Please don't.
Sorry, right, I won't, actually.
So...
Boomba.
Yeah.
Cult Boomba.
Perfect. But yeah, so...
Died. King Explosion Murder.
Anyway, so yeah, her abilities and abilities that are used by mages that are very prominent in the Cult of Panora are kind of the same. Very interesting indeed. You know, might be a bit of a hint to her past. Nick, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, we'll see. But that's actually all I have on her for the moment, although it looks like I have some questions that I did not see until just now.
It magically appeared.
How about that? So Amanda, how about you read them off, and
so,
I'm just gonna freaking wing it.
How long have you had Cecilia planned as a character?
So she was actually always going to be involved in the Infinity. Well, not always. I was gonna say before I started writing it. Before we started our collab specifically, she was already going to be a character.
Ah.
She was always going to be, I would say that the first time I thought up, Amelia was probably about 2 or 3 years ago.
Oh, okay.
And she was always going to be intended to be a, she was originally going to be intended as a rival for, Elra. Aria. Well, Elra at the time, because Aria and Elra were still the same people.
Right. So... How many iterations of Cecilia have you had?
I would say technically, I would probably say at this point 3 officially. I mean, every iteration, like every collab that we do or in every story, it's like that it's always a different iteration of the same characters because they always evolve a little bit here and there. But there's been 3.
I would say 4.
You would say 4?
Yeah, because I mean, it could have just been that it was the character development, because it took the one Killer Lab took a place later on than any of the other ones. It was the one where I'm sorry, Z, it'll probably make you want to read it. It was the one where Osa got adopted by Farron as a kid, along with
her
sisters.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I was counting that one as one. I was counting the original as one, and I was counting modern one as one.
Oh, I was counting the one in Clobia's as its own as well.
Oh, yes. Okay, so yeah, we'll say 4.
That one was like, well, what are you gonna say to him? The first thing, bend me over the table. It's just like, oh my god.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. So we're gonna say 4 iterations.
All right. So when will we see Cecilia again in the Fuenian Tales, and will there be a story focused on her specifically?
There's a chance she might make a cameo in the Fel Ren, but most likely she's going to take place in the next long form one. Basically, the latest she's going to appear will end up being in one that's going to be a collaborative one down the road, which is going to be called Knights of the Light's Wisdom.
So excited for that one. So what's Cecilia's opinion what kind of witch is Cecilia in Aething?
So she is a dark mage. She mainly uses folk powers that are associated with the spirit goddess Penumbra.
Mm-hmm.
But she works primarily with the Efwinian goddess of Majere.
Ha. I see, mm-hmm. I see.
Yeah, that is a play on things, and a reference to real world stuff. But yeah, she is she very much has a very close bond with both the Fuenian spirit gods and with Majere herself.
Mm-hmm.
But she mostly focuses on the darker powers specifically because that just happens to be the path that she went down when she was training in as a witch.
All right. So what's, speaking of darker paths, what's Cecilia's opinion on the cult of Panora?
She thinks that the cult itself is extremely dangerous, but she sees a lot of the people within it as victims. Because she believes that the people who are members of the cult of Panora are being taken advantage of by greater powers within. And she's not wrong, honestly. And this is actually just kind of as a segue here. This is pretty much the way it is with most cults. It's usually the people who are in it are really just victims of themselves that are being taken advantage of by the leaders.
Rip.
So she actually has a very healthy viewpoint of the cult of Panora. And it's almost as if she has experience with that sort of thing.
Oh, no.
Mm-hmm.
So how old is Cecilia, speaking of experience?
I would say at this point, well, it depends really, because it depends on at what point in the stories. But I'm going to say as during Brooders, we're going to say she was 26.
Yeah, I was going to say based on her, the one where she appears. She's appeared so far.
In Brooder, she's 26.
Okay.
But, you know, she's probably going to be early 30s by the time of her next appearance.
Okay, cool. So is, last question, is Cecilia an LGBTQ plus character?
Yes, actually, she is bi.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, I guess she would be considered pan, probably.
Ooh. Looking at you, Cece.
She would adore you.
I'd never get away with any self-degradation, degrading jokes.
You would. She would step on you so gently.
Anyways, so the next stream is tomorrow. Tomorrow, we're doing a Jackbox stream. It'll probably last for about an hour. I'm not sure if it'll go much later than that. It all depends how many people we have. It was requested by one of my Discord peoples, which was there we go. Now we're on the right screen. Which was if you're on the Discord, you can request Jackbox streams and all that. I have no problem doing that for my peoples because I love them. But we frequently do Jackbox streams to celebrate things and whatnot. And you know,
I just love the yes that's there.
Yes. So actually the two people that I've been chatting a lot tonight, Bloody Furball, who is also a streamer, and Zareth Valdikir, whatever, I'm not gonna try it. I'm sorry. Z. so Bloody and Z will actually both be there. They've at least both showed interest, so I'm going to be giving them their temporary role in the server so they have access to everything. But as long as you join the server and you follow our rules and everything, and you mesh well enough with everyone else, then, you know, you get full membership to the server, and that opens you up to being able to join in on the on our Jackbox streams as an actual player, join in the chat, like, and I mean, like, chitty chat, not texty chat, but, so that's tomorrow. We'll be doing that tomorrow. I haven't decided if I'm going to still do my Oblivion stream. I'm probably not, because it's been a very long week. I'm probably just going to focus on the Jackbox stream, and then it'll be that. And so the person who requested it to be drawful, so we'll be doing a bunch of drawings. It'll be fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking forward to it. I love it when we all get together. But otherwise, the next stream after that will be Monday, unless my back is too fucked up or something.
Well, hopefully that's not the case.
Yeah. As long as everything goes well, I don't have any appointments or vet appointments or anything this time around. Because Monday's stream got canceled this time because my dog got her her teeth done, and she was quite miserable when she came home. So I was like, nah, I'm not going to bother with the stream. I'm going to sit here and hold her paw.
Aww.
She actually slept in my lap for quite a while. Bloody can't draw for carrots, but he'll try his best. You know, Bloody, that's all that matters.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be
that
fun.
Is what matters.
We always have a blast with it. And I'm like, as long as I have three players, I'm happy. But we should have at least five. Between, me, you, Z, Bloody, and Ren. And then yeah, possibly Ruby. Good. So that will be pretty good.
That'll be a decent size. Mm-hmm. I think we'll be good.
Yeah. Anyways. That's all we have for tonight.
I have a couple. Okay, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. I was just going to switch over to the credits screen because I just wanted to point out something. There's only one character left on this banner that hasn't been introduced yet. So I'm excited for that. And that's the guy all the way down at the far end on the other side of the screen for me. But I realized that today. I'm like, oh my god, there's only one character left that hasn't been introduced that's actually a very important character.
And we're a whole, like, 60 chapters in.
I know. We're halfway through the story. I'm so excited for Whispers, but, like, at the same time, I'm like, oh my god. I can't imagine not working on When Souls Awaken, honestly, at this point. It's weird.
I'm looking forward to Whispers, though.
Me too. Okay, so, back to Cease Focus real quick.
Yeah, so just a couple things. So tomorrow morning is when the next episode of the Felwren drops. This one's going to give a little bit of insight to the twins and their reason for traveling that visited. Next episode will also be available on my Patreon. And also I am doing tarot readings and oracle dice readings for anybody that wishes to pay for them. You can get to those using my link tree, which I'll post down. Let me just do that real quick.
While she's throwing up her link trees, and that's a good reason to be active as a reader on our things and stuff, because sometimes we do giveaways of, you know, this stuff.
Yeah, there will be times sometimes where I'll just be like, hey, if you read such and such chapters of the Ithuanian Tales or of When Souls Awaken, then I'll do a free tarot reading, for example, or something like that.
Well, it's so far we've done it in the past as an active reader, which means that when you read, you at least like the chapter, or like the hit the little heart button on Tapas, or leave comments.
Yeah, if there's a way that we can tell that you've been active and like engaging with our content, then occasionally we will do a giveaway, especially if we're like approaching a milestone or something.
Yeah, it's always fun.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'll draw someone a picture.
That would be good.
Draw their monster.
And you know, like I said, feel free to interact with Cease using the
That's exciting. Z's going to spend tomorrow and Saturday catching up with stories. I'm super excited to see what you think of everything with When Souls Awaken.
Oh yeah, we got a lot going on with the Felwren too. But that's all I had. I just wanted to throw those out there. All
right. And as just like Cease, I have stuff dropping tomorrow as well. As I mentioned, I have chapter 64 dropping for free, and then 65 and 66 dropping on Patreon. But you can read my stuff on Fictionate, Wattpad, or Tapas. Tapas is currently the most beneficial. Fictionate, it's free on all of them, but Tapas, if I have enough subscribers, I can unlock ad revenue and whatnot, and hopefully eventually get a big enough following where I can actually profit off of that. With Fictionate, eventually I'll be switching it to charging on there. Fictionate is a really awesome website. I've really enjoyed posting on there. It's not the best for statistics, but like I was talking to one of their people and they're like, "Oh, well, I'll tell the admin about that." I was like, "Oh, cool." So the nicest thing about Fictionate is that you really do get a decent amount of visibility on there for your stories. I hope I get to too. I do have a few subscribers on Patreon, and it means the absolute world to me that these people believe in me that much, because I am working my ass off to try and make this work.
And I really recommend anybody check out Hopeful Attempts Linktree and check out her coffee and her Patreon, because not only do you get early access to her content, but also anyone that joins Hopeful Attempts Patreon Will also get a basic tarot reading from me as a courtesy and as a thank you from me personally, because that's just one of the many ways that I want to support her.
Yeah. So anyways, thanks again for everyone who came and watched the stream. Thank you for both of you, you know, chatting with us and everything. And thank you, Ruby, for coming and watching this later on, whether it's on Twitch or YouTube. I don't really care. Either way, I really appreciate everyone. And thank you so much again for lurking, Edwick. I appreciate the hell out of you. And thanks just for
thank
everything.
You all so much.
I love you guys. You're all wonderful. Have a wonderful night. I'll see you all tomorrow. Toodles.
Yep. Have a good one.